Okay, good afternoon one and all. We will be starting our practicals for CCN. The list of practical is in front of you. The first practical study of networking, PC network, TCP/IP configuration, construction of CAT5, study of LAN, simulation and implementation of bit stuffing, simulation of cyclic redundancy code, configuration of network topology using packet tracer, study of stop and wait protocol, study of token bucket algorithm, simulation of distance vector routing algorithm. Everything can be performed online. Today we'll start with the typical experiments, a construction of a CAT5 Ethernet cable, straight cable and cross cable. Before that, going to the first practical, we'll just have an introduction to the type of cables that we are utilizing for our CCN or the in general data networking. The typical type of transmission media that we are utilizing are the twisted pair cable, the coaxial cable, fiber optic cable, then we have a wireless type of connectivity. The wireless type of connectivity may be with the help of microwave type of link that is being established, or with the help of wireless access points that are suitable for our campus-wide networking. For the campus-wide networking, we are utilizing wired network as well as wireless network. In case of whenever we see the type of cables that are utilized, the type of cables that are utilized in our campus, if we are utilizing the connectivity to the switches from the desktop terminal, then we are utilizing this particular type of cable. This cable is a patch cord, typically known as a UTP cable, a category 6 UTP cable. It's a twisted pair cable. The configuration associated with this is, we have this typically known as a RJ45 jack. For this RJ45 jack, we have this RJ45 jack at both the ends, and we have different types of conductors inside this unshielded twisted pair cable. There are total 8 conductors which are connected to the RJ45 jack. The RJ45 jack where we are actually placing this UTP cable. How to prepare this cable, that we are going to learn. But at present, just note that we are utilizing the UTP cable. All over India, we are utilizing a specific standard associated with this cable. That standard is EIA568B standard. EIA568B standards, nowadays we are utilizing category 6, even if for your practicals we have category 5, but we will use a upgraded category 6 type of cable. The category 6, the type of connectivity is again similar one. The type of connectivity for CAT5 as well as CAT6 is again the similar one. The typical transmission media that we are utilizing, we'll just go through this particular presentation for some time. The transmission media can be classified as a guided media and an unguided media. The cable that we are utilizing are two types of cable. One is the optical fiber cable and second is the copper cable. Copper cable is a conductive type of cable. The conductive type of cable for both the guided as well as unguided media, we are sending the information as the electromagnetic signal. The light is also an electromagnetic signal, and the electrical signals that are conducted through the conductive cable are also the electromagnetic signals. So we have two types of medias, guided media as well as a unguided media. For our data networking, we are utilizing twisted pair cable, coaxial cables and fiber optic cables. The coaxial cables are the similar cables with which typically your dish antenna is connected to the TV receiver. Previously, we were utilizing coaxial cable. The coaxial cable was most suitable for bus type of topology. But nowadays, all over campus of our campus, we are utilizing star type of topology. And for star type of topology, we are utilizing such cables, which are the twisted pair cables. And if the distance between the stations, between the networks, between the devices, the networking devices, goes beyond 100 meter, either we are extending the star network or we are utilizing optical fiber cable as the backbone. The optical fiber cable as the backbone, if the distance between the stations is more than 100 meters. The twisted pair cables are the copper conductors. So as the length of this copper conductor goes on increasing, resistance offered by the copper conductor goes on increasing. That is obvious. And that's why there is always a limit for the length of this category 6 type of cable. The category 6 type of cables that we are utilizing are actually providing us the 1 gigabit type of bandwidth or 1 gigabit bandwidth. The twisted pair cable, copper is the conductor. It's formed by 2 insulated copper wires that are twisted with each other in order to minimize the radio frequency interference as the electromagnetic signal propagates over the length of a conducting material. The radio frequency interference as well as the electromagnetic interference is bound to happen. And that's why we are actually twisting the conductors such that the radio frequency interference as well as the generated electromagnetic interference cancels each other and there is no disturbance or the error that is associated with the conductive type of material. The multiple pairs, there are multiple pairs, almost 4 pairs are there inside this UTP cable. There are 2 different configurations again for the twisted pair cables. The first is the shielded twisted pair and another is the unshielded twisted pair. For the figure you can see, this is the typical configuration of a shielded twisted pair and it's the unshielded twisted pair. A plastic encasement is provided for the UTP type of cable and for the STP type of cable, the set of twisted pairs are wrapped in a foil shielding so that the electromagnetic interference is totally minimized. But it's not at all practically totally minimized. As the length goes on increasing, the electromagnetic radiations or the conductors carrying the electromagnetic signal turns into antenna, the energy is emitted to the atmosphere or radiated to the atmosphere and that causes loss of the signal. That's why the length associated with the UTP cable is quite restricted one. But the bandwidth that is supported by the conductive type of material is also quite high. Almost 100 Mbps to 1 Gbps bandwidth is supported by the category 6 cables that we are utilizing in our laboratory. There are 7 different categories associated with unshielded twisted pair. Here only 5 are listed. Category 6 cable can be used at data at 1000 Gbps and category 7 cables, which are still utilized in the research laboratories, we are utilizing those cables for data at 10 gigabits per second. Very fast Ethernet, for very fast type of Ethernet. Category 1 type of cable is typically a conductive type of cable. It can only carry the voice signal. So the bandwidth. Screen is not visible. Okay. Presentation is not visible. Okay, I will just again. Is it the problem with all? You can switch on your mic and tell me. Is it visible now? Okay. We have 7 different categories, category 1, 2, category 7, category 6 cable, that are the cables that we are utilizing in our laboratory. The cable that I am showing to you, it's a category 6 type of cable, it's a patch cord. There are 4 different conductors, 4 pair of conductors in the unshielded twisted pair. The configuration that is supported for the unshielded twisted pair, we are utilizing this because they are relatively inexpensive and easy to install and manage. But if we want to utilize those UTP cables for more than 100 megabits per second, then for short length only we can utilize. As the length goes on increasing, if the high bandwidth is to be achieved, the conductive cables generates the electromagnetic interference and that creates a high rate of attenuation. But typically category 6 and category 7 cables, still we are able to utilize it for the bandwidth of almost around 10 gigabits per second. 10 gigabits per second, that's a huge type of bandwidth with the common conductive cable or the copper cable. The STP type of cables, shielded twisted pair cables, provide us a higher bandwidth. They are less sensitive since the shielding is provided to the twisted, one twisted pair, a shielding is provided. But again, the drawback is they are costlier and harder to install. It's very difficult to provide a typical RJ45 type of connectors to be connected to the shielded twisted pair. The connectors that are utilized for our UTP cable, these cables, this particular connector is known as a RJ45 type of conductor. This RJ45 type of conductor, it has 8 conductive strips which helps us in providing the connectivity with support of 8 conductive cables for the unshielded twisted pair cable, UTP cable that we are utilizing. Then another type of configuration, coaxial cable. For the coaxial cable, we have 2 types of conductors. The first is the copper conductor and second type of conductor is a braided outer conductor. And for providing the insulation in between copper conductor and the braided outer conductor, we have a dielectric insulation having an impedance of almost 50 ohms so that a proper shielding for the 2 conductors is provided so that the devices or the cables can be operated at a higher frequency. That was one of the advantage of providing the dielectric insulation between the copper conductor and the braided outer conductor for the coaxial cable. And in order to provide sufficient mechanical strength, a PVC outer covering is provided for the coaxial cables. Typically, we are not at all utilizing this type of cables, but for bus type of topology, still coaxial cables are quite suitable. There are again 2 different configurations associated with the coaxial cable, thin net, thick net, but at present, we will not at all go. Then the third type of cable is the optical fiber cable, where the type of propagation that we are utilizing for the optical fiber cable is the light is propagated through a conducting glass or a plastic core, through a glass or a plastic core, which is again surrounded by a cladding material. The cladding material is again a glass material of having a different refractive index, and the signal is propagated by utilizing the total internal reflection. The total internal reflection, this is the specified type of reflection that is supported for the optical fiber core material, where core material is a glass material, cladding material is also a glass material. These two glass material or the plastic material are separated by a separate or are differentiated by change in the refractive index for the material, and with the help of angle of incidence and the change in the refractive index, we can achieve a total internal reflection. The biggest advantage of these particular types of fibers is that attenuation offered by these fibers is very, very, very low, almost around 0.001 dB per kilometer, whenever that optical fiber is operated at a specific wavelength. That is very, very, very low, and that's why typically if we are needing a repeater for after every 100 meters for a UTP cable, we need a repeater for a properly operated or operated wavelength optical fiber every after either 50 kilometers, even after 100 kilometers. See that the attenuation offered is very, very low. That is the biggest advantage. And second is the bandwidth offered by the optical fiber is very, very high. Millions of TV channels can be propagated over a long distance, with the support of thin glass fibers. That is the biggest advantage. And that's why for all our data networks, if we want to select the backbone is an optical fiber cable. But the cost associated for less than 100 meters, still the cost associated with the UTP cable is quite low. So we can create one patch cord just in rupees 2 to 3 with the cost included for the fabrication of the cable, the cost included for the fabrication of and providing the connectivity with RJ45 type of connector. So this much information related to the communication media is quite sufficient. Then we'll go directly to the how we are actually preparing this UTP cable, category 5 UTP cable. For that we'll go to another presentation. See this configuration, how we are actually preparing. This is the category 5E or category 6 type of cable that we prepare during this particular Ethernet cable preparation practical. These are the various frequency ranges, operating frequency ranges for the category 5, category 5E, category 6 or category 6A, which is typically a category 7 cable nowadays, which is utilizing EIA 568B standard actually helps us in maintaining a proper standardization according to the international standards, providing the specified type of color coding for the specific conductors for the UTP cable. Whenever we see this configuration, see this, it's actually inside of a UTP cable. We have four pairs of twisted wiring. The four pairs of twisted wiring, see here, this particular one pair blue, and nearby is known as a white blue, then orange, nearby twisted conductor is known as a white orange, then brown and white brown, and green and white green. That is the nomenclature that is utilized for the Ethernet category 6 type of cable. This Ethernet, the pin sequence with the support of this jack, this is a RJ45 jack. The RJ45 jack this RJ45 jack. This is the RJ45 jack, which has pin positions, different pin positions. These pin positions are 1 to 8. This is a plastic supporting the conductive material for the RJ45 plug. It's 8 PHC. That means 8 conductors are provided. 8 pieces, 8 conductors are provided for this RJ45 jack. And the sequence we are following according to Industry 568B standard is the pin number 1 is white orange, pin number 2 is orange, pin number 3 is white green, pin number 4 is blue, pin number 5 is white blue, pin number 6 is green, pin number 7 is white brown, and pin number 8 is brown. These are the color codes that are assigned to the conductors according to the EIA 568B standard. We are utilizing this particular standard in the European countries, as well as we are utilizing this particular standard in all over India and some eastern countries. In US, they are utilizing EIA 568A standard. Only the color coding sequence is different for 568A and 568B. But we are utilizing this 568B color coding in order to prepare the conductive type of cables, the patch cords, the UTP cables that you can see everywhere in the laboratory. For the Ethernet cable, we are utilizing actually only two pairs. One pair for transmission and second pair for reception or receiving the data. Remaining four slots are specifically provided to provide power on Ethernet, where suitable power can be provided with the additional conductors, and still two are unutilized. Or you can provide power on to additional devices, additional networking devices, or which are also known as the power pass type of Ethernet cables. If all the 8 are utilized, out of 8, 4 are utilized only for transmission and receiving, and remaining 4 conductors are utilized to provide the power supply. At present, for the laboratory cables, we are utilizing only 2 pairs. One pair for transmission, second pair for reception. One pair means, that means 2 conductors. 2 conductors for transmission, 2 conductors for reception. So whenever we are defining pin number 1, 2, 3 and pin number 6, and at both the ends of the conductor, if we are following the same sequence of the color codes, that particular cable is known as a straight cable. How to prepare this particular cable? We are utilizing this tool. This tool is known as a crimping tool. Crimping tool, we can utilize it for cutting, removing the insulation, at the same time providing the fixing type of arrangement for the RJ45 type of plug. RJ45 type of plug I have shown to you. Then we need scissors to remove the insulations for the conductors. I will also show you how actually the cables are prepared. See here. There are four different pairs. Remember again, orange, white orange, brown, white brown, blue, white blue, and green, white green. These are 8 conductors. Remove the insulation, strip off the cable sheath, and then align the colored wires according to the specific order. This is the specific order, that is white orange, orange, then white green, then blue, then white blue, then green, then white brown and brown. This is the sequence of the conductor. It's a specific sequence of the conductor. Whenever we are utilizing the similar type of configuration at both the ends, that particular cable is known as a straight through cable. The straight through cables, whenever the devices that are to be connected are at two different levels, then we are utilizing a straight through cable. And whenever the devices are at same level, that means I want to connect one desktop computer to another desktop computer without utilizing any additional device in between the two computers, I can provide the connectivity. I can provide the connectivity, but that particular cable needs to be a cross over or cross cable. Cross cable, UTP cable, crossover Ethernet cable. It's also known as a cross cable. It's also known as a crossover cable. It's also known as a crossover UTP cable. Whenever the devices are at the same level, that means if I want to connect two switches, I will utilize a cross cable. If I want to connect two computers, I will utilize a cross cable. If I want to connect a switch to my desktop, switch to my laptop, then I will utilize a straight cable. Remember this, it will be helpful for you. Host A, host B, I'm showing this will be host A and this will be host B. And the color combination will be like this. Pin number 1 will be always a white orange. Pin number 2 will be orange. Pin number 3 will be white green, then blue, then white blue, then green. When this sequence is maintained at the two ends, it's the straight through cable. That's how we are actually preparing the straight through cable. Whenever we need to change the order of transmission and reception, we are actually utilizing a crossover type of cable. That means if the two computers are to be directly connected, as shown, I need to provide a crossover type of connection. And simple thing to remember is that pin number 1 is connected to pin number 3 at the other end. Pin number 2 is connected to pin number 6. See here, pin number 2, orange, pin number 6. 1:3, 2:6, and vice versa. Yes, that is a crossover cable. Yes, anything? Any doubt? Anything? Suddenly, I got some noise. Are you able to see this particular screen? It's the crossover type of cable, that is crossover screen. Yes, correct. We are on the crossover type of connectivity where, remember, pin number 1 is connected to pin number 3 at the other end. Pin number 2 is connected to pin number 6 at the other end. Pin number 3 is different. Pin number and vice versa. 1 is connected to 3, 2 is connected to 6. For other end, pin number 3 is connected to pin number 1, other way around, and that's a crossover. That is, the transmitter part of one end is connected to the receiver part, and receiver part of the first other end is connected to the transmitter part. That's how a crossover cable is prepared, which is utilized to connect the devices at same level. Here two computers are shown. If I am utilizing two switches, I mean, all of you might have seen one box that is kept in the computer lab for our department. In that box, we have a network interfacing device. This network interfacing device or network switching device is a managed switch that and all our desktop computers in the laboratory are connected to that manual, that managed switch, that's a networking equipment with the help of this type of cable. It's a category 6 type of cable, which is connected from the desktop computer to the switch that is kept at the central position, and this switch is connected to the various switches in our department. At the same time, one of the connector from those switches is connected to the switch that is available at the data center. The data center for our campus is available in the IT department at the ground floor, from where, with the help of such category 6 cables, if the distance is less than 100 meters, we are utilizing category 6 cable. If the distance between the switches is more than 100 meters, we are utilizing optical fiber as the backbone for our entire campus. That's how we are actually creating the cables, category 6 type of cables. This is for crossover. Pin number 1, having a specific white orange, is connected to pin number 3. Pin number 2 is connected to pin number 6. See the same color. Then pin number 3 is connected to pin number 1. 4 as usual, 5 as usual. Pin number 6 is then connected to pin number 2. This configuration is known as a crossover configuration. A crossover configuration, we are utilizing pin number 4, 5 and 7, 8. 4, 5 and 7, 8. We are maintaining the same sequence so that power pass cables can be prepared with the help of the conductors that are utilized for pin number 4, 5 and 7, 8. That's how an Ethernet cable is prepared. See, these are the sequences that are to be properly maintained. And see here, all the conductors are cut at the same length. Then they are put inside the RJ45 jack. Insert these wires in RJ45 jack. And we are utilizing a crimping tool to press this portion of the RJ45 jack so that the upper part of the conductors actually touches the conductive material of this RJ45 plug. And that's how we are actually preparing the cable. That's how we are pressing that RJ45 jack with the help of this tool. This is known as a crimping tool. See here, other end of the RJ45 jack. Here, from one end, we are inserting the cables. At the other end, we are actually pressing that plug, RJ45 plug, so that the wires are tightly connected to the conductors of RJ45 jack. This is the correct type of connectivity that is offered. See here. Whenever a switch is connected to a laptop computer, we are utilizing a straight through cable. Whenever these two laptops are to be connected, we are utilizing a crossover type of cable. Whenever we are connecting the devices at same level, a crossover cable is required. Remember always this. A crossover cable is required whenever the devices at same level are to be connected. I will show you again one video. Thank you. here. Watch carefully this particular video, which will show you how actually we are preparing the cable. We need a crimping tool. This is known as a crimping tool. We have the plastic jacket. Then with the help of crimping tool only, we are removing the upper sheath for the plastic jacket or the elastic jacket, and we are separating out the four pair of conductors. The four pair of conductors see, every pair is a shielded pair, twisted pair, not shielded, it's a twisted pair. From that, we are first of all straightening the upper part of the cable. And arranging in the specified color codes. The specified color codes, a specified sequence. Remember again, we are utilizing EIA, Electronic Industry Association, EIA 568B standard for preparation of these cables, so that this everywhere the standard is maintained. No one will connect whatever sequence. If whatever sequence of cable is utilized, then the user will not at all identify which terminal is the transmitter terminal, which terminal is a receiver terminal. That's why we are maintaining a specific standard that is associated with this UTP cable. Now they are properly arranged. For that specified part only, the twisting is removed. Inside the cable, all these are the twisted conductors. Now all these conductors are cut into a similar size. A specified sequence has to be maintained. The conductors can be very easily identified. See here. Orange, white, orange, orange. Then white, green, blue. A specified sequence. The cables are straightened, made to equal length. And then they are inserted into the RJ45 jack. It's a RJ45 jack where they are inserted. And the portion where all the conductors are seen, that RJ45 plug is pressed so that the conductors touches the conducting material of RJ45. An elastic sheath is provided. That's a permanent connection. If one of the conductor is not at all touching, then you have to cut that RJ45 jack, and that RJ45 jack will not at all be utilized again. Once a RJ45 plug is pressed, and if the cable fails, then you have to cut again that RJ45 jack. That RJ45 jack is to be thrown out and new RJ45 jack is to be utilized. That's how actually we are preparing the category 6 cables. any doubt associated with this first practical. That's how we are actually creating the category 6 cables. Any doubt, you can switch on, unmute yourself, your panelist, unmute yourself and ask any sort of doubt. You are not properly connected, you can ask your doubt in the chat window.
I was having doubt.
Yeah. Divish.
Hello.
Divish, go on.
Sir, I asked that doubt first also, that why it is having that two gap in that wires. Why is that so?
Means I didn't get you. Two gaps means?
Means if first wire is there, it is connected to that receiver and third pin.
That's for providing the crossover type of. That's for preparing. We are preparing two different types of cables. The first cable is the straight cable. Then second cable is a crossover cable. If the devices at same level are to be connected, then we need a crossover cable. Because transmitting part of one end needs to be connected to the receiving part of the other terminal. And that's why a cross cable. That is, one is connected to pin number 3. Pin number 2 at one end is connected to pin number 6. Then vice versa for the other end. Pin number 3 is connected to pin number 1 of the other end. 4 is similar, 5 is similar, then 6 is the pin number 2 at the other end. And this forms actually the crossover cable. That is, whenever the devices are at the same level, switch-to-switch connectivity, desktop-to-desktop connectivity, laptop-to-laptop directly can be connected by connecting this Ethernet cable. This is the Ethernet cable that we are utilizing to provide the data connectivity for the two terminals. But if we want to utilize in our star type of topology, then we are connecting all this to the switch or hub that is placed in between. In case of switch or hub available in our department, you might have seen one box that is kept where all the terminals, desktop terminals are connected. Desktop terminals are connected from the desktop terminal to the switch. We are utilizing the connecting cable, UTP. We are utilizing category 6 type of cable. But whenever the devices are at the same level, we need to provide a crossover type of connectivity. Then only the transmitter and receiver part for the both the nodes will function. Still doubt. Yes, Divesh.
Sir, I understood. Means when it will be of same category, then we have to use crossover cable.
Yeah, correct.
Right now.
Yeah, correct.
And when we are giving it to hub or our station, then we have to connect that
straight cable. Correct.
Straight cables. Yeah.
See, if you have only two laptops, it's not at all necessary to procure the in-between device. The cost of that switch is quite high. If it's a managed switch, then again the cost is quite high. If it's a Cisco switch, then a 24-port Cisco managed switch will cost you around 1.5 lakhs. If it's a simple 8-port switch, then still it will cost you around 2000 to 4000 rupees. But if you want to connect only two laptops, then prepare a crossover cable and the two laptops can be connected to each other. In the same way, if I want to...
Okay, sir, got it.
Yeah, in the same way, if I want to increase the my star network. So, I have 24 desktop or 24 laptops that are connected to one switch. Now, if I have additional 10 devices, then I have to procure another switch. But for those 10 computers to be connected to the first 24 computers, I need a proper connectivity in between the two switches. So switch to switch connectivity will be again a crossover type of cable. And from switch to desktop terminal, the connectivity will be a straight over cable. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Anything related to this, you can ask. Unmute yourself. All our panelists, unmute yourself and just ask. If you can prepare these cables immediately after engineering, you can start your startup that you are a networking engineer. Almost 1000 rupees per node. That is preparation and providing the connectivity with this category 6 cable is taken by this particular networking professional. And there is a huge scope. Everywhere, if there are 4 to 5 terminals for a small, even a business shop, they need to have all the terminals connected in the network. And for providing that connectivity, you must have the knowledge associated with the crossover cables and the straight cables and how they are connected, how they are prepared and connected to the switches. Anything, any more doubt? For this practical, you can search Google for EIA568B standard, various tutorials that are available, various videos that are available, but again everywhere we are utilizing EIA568B standard for our European and Indian subcontinent. So the all the patch cords that I have shown you in front of my cam is again a category 6 type of cable. It's a straight type of cable that's provided by the service provider to me. Any more doubt, anything? Shall we move on to the second practical? Yes. Speak out. It should be interactive. At least practical must be interactive. If you are not at all interactive, some things might be missed from me. You will not at all ask up to the end of the practical. For this particular course, we have an external exam. We will take, I have shown you the list of the practicals, the 10 practicals that are available, but out of those 10 practicals, many are just theoretical practicals, study of networking, TCP/IP configuration, study of LAN. Only the first practical that we have taken, construction of Cat5 Ethernet cable, straight and crossover. That's actually only available. We can do some practicals. All other practicals for first 4 are the study practicals. But we will add some practical contents for every practical where we will see the TCP/IP configuration for our desktop computer. Then we will also see the type of topology, then we'll also see what are the various configurations that are supported for the local area network, the addressing. Then we'll go to the next set of practicals. So the first practical, Cat5 Ethernet cable, is over. Remaining three practicals are the theory practicals, which we will manage with some practical contents that are shown. Any doubt? Can we move on to the second practical? For second practical, again, I will take the help of Saurabh Ghadge. I'm changing his role to presenter. Saurabh, share your screen. I will tell you what to do.
Okay, sir. Can you see me, sir?
Yeah.
On my screen, sir?
Yeah, your screen is visible. So we will utilize some networking commands. Those commands are utilized at the command prompt for your Windows terminal. It can be also utilized at the command prompt or the terminal window for the Linux type of operating system. So just go to the command prompt by giving type here to search cmd. Or yeah, you can go to command prompt directly. Yeah.
Yes. Is that it, sir?
Yeah. Run it. Just run as an administrator or just open it. Yeah. It's available to you. Now you want to check your terminal. Whether your terminal, you are of course connected to the internet, but if some browsers fails and still you are part of the internetwork, that is, you are connected to the internet, then how to check that? For that, give the command, say ping, P-I-N-G, space, and give any domain name, say google.com. Everyone, please observe this. These are the networking commands that are utilized by the network administrator to find. Just enter it. Enter whether the terminals are part of the network or not. Are you getting my voice?
Sir?
Are you getting my voice?
Hello, sir. You are not audible. No, sir. Yes.
Yeah, okay. The command, I think everyone can see the command prompt window. See here, google.com is resolved into a IP version 6 address. This is a 128-bit address associated with google.com. It's the 128-bit IP address that is being utilized. This type of version is the IP version 6. Whenever you are getting the reply, the meaning of this particular command is that you are sending four different packets to google.com. Each packet length is 32 bytes and Google is responding within a specified time duration. That's why time is equal to 94 milliseconds, time is equal to 77 milliseconds, time is equal to 88 milliseconds. That's the time required for the loopback packet. That means you are sending 32 bytes and Google is acknowledging those 32 bytes and again sending back to you. That's why this particular command is very, very useful command to check whether your terminal is part of the network or not. The command can be utilized to check whether your terminal is part of the internal network or not. If there are multiple terminals that are connected under local area network, I can find out whether I am able to connect with other terminals or not. Whether all terminals are connected to your network for finding out that if you have already communicated with the nearby networks, you can utilize the command say ARP minus A. ARP, just give at the command prompt.
ARP
space minus A, all small, AA. Enter. See here. These are the some sort of addresses what we have discussed in our theory class. We have virtual addresses in the form of IP addresses. The internet addresses are known as the IP addresses. The number 192.168.43.229. This is the IP address that is assigned to Saurabh's terminal by the internet with which this terminal is connected to the internet. I think you are utilizing hotspot, correct?
Yes, sir.
Mobile hotspot. The second,
yes.
The second is 192.168.43.255. And all FFFFFFFF. That means you are connected to the internet with the support of hotspot. That's the meaning. And ARP minus A. Today morning we have seen that in the TCP/IP model, at the data link layer, we are utilizing ARP as well as RARP type of protocols. This ARP protocol is helping me in finding out the IP address and physical address of the terminal. IP address is continuously changing, but the physical address, your Ethernet card is D6C94B351386. It's typically a hexadecimal address, a hexadecimal address, which is also known as a media access control, MAC address of your Ethernet card. How to find out that particular address? Then the third command that is utilized at the command prompt is ipconfig. Just give it ipconfig. At command prompt, Saurabh.
Yes, sir.
At command prompt, to provide ipconfig, C-O-N-F-I-G, F-I-G, space,
okay,
space, forward slash, 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 huh? Yeah, all, A-L-L. This particular command provides the information about the network interfacing cards, whether those network interfacing cards are the Ethernet cards or wired Ethernet cards or the wireless Ethernet cards. Just enter. See, there are various interfacing cards that are supported. Again, scroll up. Yeah, wireless LAN adapter, Wi-Fi. There are various local area network connectors. The wired connectivity is provided by Ethernet adapter, and wireless connectivity is provided by wireless LAN adapter. The Ethernet adapter, see here, the second one, the Ethernet second one, Ethernet adapter with media disconnected, the Realtek PCIe gigabit Ethernet family controller. it has physical address E86A. I think all of you can view this. Then second physical address to second wireless LAN adapter 02-F4/8D. That is the second physical address. Then third physical address for wireless LAN adapter which is connected to the local area network, which is 12-F4-8D. Just scroll up again. Are there any more? Yeah. You are utilizing this particular wireless LAN adapter Wi-Fi, which is supported by Qualcomm. This Qualcomm is the company which is actually providing us the device driver for the wireless network adapter, which has again a physical address 00F48D8C. This is the physical address at which now you are connected to the internet. And this is the physical address at which the packets are properly destined. We are utilizing this wireless LAN adapter Wi-Fi supported by Qualcomm. Remaining adapters are not at all utilized. For the Wi-Fi connectivity, this is the wireless LAN adapter Wi-Fi supported by Qualcomm. That is utilized by your laptop when it's getting connected to the internet. That's how I can find out the physical addresses and which adapter is utilized for providing me the connectivity with the other terminals. Whenever I am connecting the Ethernet cable to your laptop, immediately the Ethernet adapter will be activated and a IP address, the IP address, IP version 4 address for this Wi-Fi adapter is 192.168.43.4. This is available. But whenever you are connected with a Ethernet cable, with an Ethernet cable to say a switch, which is actually providing us a connectivity with the external network, then another IP address will be allocated to your terminal. That is, a virtual IP address is assigned to your terminal. You cannot change the physical address of your terminal. You cannot change the MAC address of your terminal. You cannot change the address of the adapters, network adapters. In the previous lectures, I have told you, your desktop terminal becomes a workstation if it has the capability to connect to the network. And that capability is provided by these network adapters which are connected to your computer. These network adapters are actually providing us a proper connectivity to the external network. And how to find out? That is by utilizing ipconfig /all. Okay.
Okay.
Okay, just close down this command prompt now. And in the browser, just give what is my ip.com. No space. Continuous. What is my IP? IP.com. Just enter.
Is that it, sir?
Okay. Click the first one. Just click one. Click that. See here. 157.47.18.71. This is the IP address that is being allocated to your terminal. This is allocated by a service provider, an internet service provider for your terminal. The internet service provider is the Jio network. You are connected with the help of Jio, correct?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Yeah. By creating a hotspot with the help of Jio, you are connected to the internet. And your service provider, Jio, is providing you the IP address 157.47.18.71. Since this IP address is allocated, you have a virtual address which is allocated to your data terminal. And that's why you are part of the data network. There are two different types of IP addresses. The internal IP addresses and the external IP addresses. If you recall, the range of IP address typically was 192.168.43.something. That was the internal IP address which was allocated to your network. But this is the public domain IP address that is allocated to your terminal. And since a public domain IP address is allocated to your terminal or your entire network, that's why you are part of the network of network, that is internet. Unless and until this particular IP address is allocated to your terminal, you are not able to browse internet. This is allocated to you by the internet service provider. The internet service provider, see here, ISP, Reliance Jio Infocom Limited. That's available. What is my IP is actually providing the information associated with your public domain IP version 6 IP address. This IP address 157 is IP version 4. And below that 2409-4042 is the IP address allocated with the help of IP version 6. IP version 4 and IP version 6 are the two standards which are utilized to allocate the IP addresses to all over the hosts which are connected to the network of network. Are you getting it? Any doubt associated with this? What just we have seen? You can ask me any question. Shreyas Mane, can I make you presenter?
Yeah. Sure.
You can share your screen, Shreyas. How you are connected to internet with your laptop and again hotspot or connected to the broadband?
Broadband, sir.
Okay. Then again we can see other case. Just share your screen.
I have selected share screen. After that, there are
options. Those are out of that, select the upper one. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Go to command prompt.
Yes,
find out ipconfig/all. Give the command ipconfig/all. Space. All. Yeah. See here, Ethernet adapter. Find out IP address that is being allocated. You are connected by Ethernet adapter, correct?
Yes, sir.
Connect, correct. Then the IP version 4 address that is being allocated to your terminal is 192.168. Just scroll upwards. It's a virtual Ethernet adapter. No, that's not. Okay. Intel R Ethernet connection. Yeah, correct. For your terminal, the IP address that is being allocated from the broadband, internet or intranet is 192.168.1.105. You can check whether this IP address is correct or not. Just go to the networking icon in the taskbar.
Networking icon,
Network 2, correct. Just right click it, open network and internet setting. Okay. Then go to Ethernet, correct. Go to details. Yeah. See here, 192.168.1.105 is the IP address that is being allocated. See, 1.105, 1.105. You can find out your IP address by this screen also by using the graphical user interface. See,
192.168.1.105.
This gateway is the internal IP address that is allocated to your router. Broadband service provider, you have provided you the router. Correct?
Yes, sir. Yes,
sir. You can directly give this IP address 192.168.1.1. In the browser window, just give it.
Then my browser will open up.
Your browser will open, which opens the parameters of your router. Just give it 1.1. Enter. It's a TP-Link browser. It's a TP-Link wireless router having a specific username and password, which provides the connectivity. Here you can configure your internet connectivity. You are connected by, say, just scroll down. You are connected by utilizing PPPoE, that is point to point protocol over Ethernet. See here, connect automatically for WAN. WAN is nothing but your connectivity supported by the internet service provider. Here the IP address of that is allocated is 172.16.6.123, which is allocated by your service provider. But your internal IP address starts with the range, just scroll up. See here, LAN, local area network. The starting address of your local area network is 192.168.1.1, and your terminal is allocated an IP address in the range, same range, 192.168.1.105. That was the IP address that is allocated to your terminal. This router is allocating the IP address to your terminal. Since address is now known for your terminal is part of the data. That's why addressing is very, very, very important.
Okay, sir. This value will change if there is another device, it will change like 192.168.1.
Normally right for 105. Normally for all broadband modems, this is the default IP address 192.168.1.1. And the default username and password are admin and admin. Admin and admin. But you can change even this particular IP address. You can change 192.168.1.1. This IP address you can change, but your network should be also in the same range. Then only those devices will get an internet access through this default gateway. Your terminal, the broadband router, is the default gateway, which is having the IP version 4 address of 192.168.1.1.
Okay, sir.
This router is utilizing a DHCP protocol, dynamic host configuration protocol, which is automatically allocating your terminal the IP address. Yes, what you are asking?
Do you know how the VPN system works? Like how they change the IP address of the system and still get connected to the internet?
VPN is actually providing you a tunnel in between the public network. And this tunnel is a secured tunnel. So whatever you are getting connected with the help of VPN, it's always encrypted. It's always encrypted. And no other person can decrypt, because your terminal decides what type of encryption algorithm is to be utilized by connecting to the VPN. Well, VPN is nothing but a virtual private network. A virtual private network that is created inside a public network. Not all open VPNs can be utilized to connect your WhatsApp in our campus. There are specific VPNs only. Those will help you connect the restricted sites. Not all VPNs will be utilized. But VPN is creation of a secured path, secured virtual private path in a public network. Public network, that means the service provider is providing you internet connectivity. That means a public network is allocated so that you can connect to any public computer. You can connect to google.com, you can connect to yahoo.com, you can connect to NIC website, you can connect to various websites. Those are all in the public domain. The connectivity is a public network. Inside that public network, with the help of VPN, you are creating a secured, encrypted connection path. And the protocol that is used by majority of the VPNs in India are PPTP protocol, that is point to point tunneling protocol. Just now, for your broadband type of connectivity, we have seen PPPoE, correct? It's a point to point protocol over Ethernet. That is the protocol that is supported
for
internet service provider. For VPN, we are utilizing PPTP protocol, point to point tunneling protocol. Okay.
Yes, sir. So, as you before in the starting of this lecture, you told that there are two types of connections of a wire, a crossway, across.
Crossover cable and
straightforward.
Straight cable.
When we are connecting to straight cable, and the hub is nothing but a connection for the internet. The main is internet will come.
Nowadays,
at
we are not at all utilizing
it will get distributed
hub
to the specific computers.
Yeah, yeah. Whenever we are utilizing hub or switch, and the connectivity is provided to your laptop or desktop, then it's a straight cable. If the devices are at same level, that means laptop to laptop, desktop to desktop, we need to utilize crossover.
Yes, sir. Because I thought that still we are using this type of technology, and if you are connecting to any switch or hub, we want to use that crossover. But like when we use the same Ethernet cable to connect to it to the switch, and we use the same if you want to exchange large files, like large size files which are in gigabytes.
That
LAN cable only to transfer the
It's not like that. That depends, the bandwidth of the cable depends on the category of the cable. Category 5 cables are utilized to provide you the bandwidth of maximum up to 100 Mbps. Category 6, 100 to 1 Gbps. Category 7, 1 Gbps to 10 Gbps. That is the bandwidth supporting capability of the fiber. Of the cable. Not fiber, of the cable. It's not that for sending the large files, you have to change the Ethernet cable. It's not like that. for connecting your terminal to
switch. We use the selector cable.
Yeah. Your voice is breaking.
Hello, sir.
Haan.
Hello.
Haan, bol.
My doubt was, we use the same Ethernet cable for connecting to the switch, and that same Ethernet cable we also use to connect two PCs when we are transferring the data in between them. So how is it possible? Like the cable is same, and it is doing two functions, like connecting. First is connecting to your router, which will provide the internet, and in second case, it's connecting to the computer also.
The type of cable, that's the beauty associated with the Windows 7 onwards terminals, which is utilizing a built-in DHCP protocol. And that's why whenever you are connecting your Ethernet cable to the desktop computers directly, you always get the IP allocation in the range of 169.254 and something. That's due to the internal DHCP server utilized by Windows, which provides automatic IP address allocation. What I have told you, if an IP address is allocated to you, your terminal is part of the network. And if the two terminals are in the same range of IP addresses, then they are able to communicate with each other very efficiently.
Okay, sir. So can you also tell what this subnet mask and DHCP servers terminologies means?
DHCP terminology, it's a dynamic host configuration protocol, which helps us. This is the actually configuration that we utilize at the data link layer of TCP/IP protocol. In case of TCP/IP protocol, today we have seen that ARP and RARP, address resolution protocol and reverse address resolution protocol. With the help of this DHCP server, we are actually allocating the IP address dynamically. The IP address, whenever your terminal is getting connected to the network, automatically the IP address is allocated. This is done by the DHCP server, which is configured in your, this is configured in your, see here, you are not giving any IP address. You are getting automatic IP address, obtain an IP address automatically. This is due to the DHCP server that is utilized for your broadband router. You can see the DHCP configuration for your broadband router. Just connect again 192.168.1.1.
Yeah, already connected.
Yeah. See here, DHCP setting. Starting address is 1.100, and that's why your terminal is allocated an IP address range between 100 and 199. 192.168.1.100. And ending address, any random address is allocated. This is the dynamic host configuration protocol IP address allocation to whatever terminal that is being connected to the data net. If you change this from 1.100 to 1.50 to 1.100, then your data terminal will be allocated a IP address within that particular range.
Okay, sir.
Particular range. That's how an IP address is dynamically allocated to your terminal. This is about DHCP. The type of IP addresses 192.168.1.105. This particular type of IP addresses are known as the class C type of IP address allocation. And for all these class C type of IP address in the version 4, we are utilizing the subnet mask 255.255.255.0. That is, I am masking all the upper bits and I am changing only the last bit. 192.168.1.1 is the IP address of your router, broadband router. And the IP address that is being allocated to your terminal is .104. same 192.168.1.104. If you connect any other terminal to your broadband router, are there any additional devices that are connected to your broadband connection? Yes, yes.
Yes, sir.
Then go to command prompt. We will see that. Command prompt. Provide the command ARP space minus A. Space minus A. Yeah.
I was having doubt that.
Yeah.
What is the static and dynamic in that?
Static means you can manually allocate the IP address. If you know the class C type of addressing schemes, you can manually address. Just go to that. Yes, close it. Close it. Go to IP version 4. No, go to network adapter. Huh? Ethernet. Just close the screen. Huh? Properties, go to properties, go to TCP/IP. Yeah, correct. Here you can manually allocate the IP address. Still, your terminal will be part of the network. Are you getting?
Okay, sir. Yes, sir.
That's how we are getting connected with the help of TCP/IP. That's our second practical. In the next practical, I was supposed to show you all these configurations. These are all TCP/IP configurations that are performed for your terminal. One of the terminal at present
1.105.
That's being allocated. Then no other terminal is connected.
No, sir, actually my mobile is connected to it. Another PC is connected.
What actually ARP-A is doing, it's actually providing you the connectivity of the nearby devices or the router connectivity for your device. Try to share some file from your mobile to your desktop. Do you know how to share?
Using what, sir?
You can can you find out the IP address of your mobile?
Yes, sir. It's 1.104.
That's at the command prompt. Give the command ping space 192.168.1.104. 104. Yeah. Now 104 is now give the command ARP minus A.
Is the same, sir.
It should be with 104. Okay, the protocol stack is not getting updated. ARP minus A is actually providing you the connectivity. Just give the command ping space 192.168.1.104 space minus T.
Minus P.
T. Turbo. Yeah. Enter.
Yeah.
Now your terminal is continuously sending the packet. 32-bit packet, it's continuously sending. This particular type of attack is known as a ping attack. And your resources, your mobile is continuously acknowledging that also. So your resources at the mobile are continuously busy in acknowledging these packets. If you have a protocol stack of your, now you can stop it by pressing Ctrl C. Now again give ARP minus A. Is it available? Still not. Though protocol stack gets updated after every 30 minutes. You can try it after 30 minutes. You will get the IP address and the physical address of your mobile. that will be seen in the protocol stack of ARP minus A.
Okay, sir.
Both the terminals are allocated dynamic IP address. So the dynamic IP address allocated to your mobile is 104, which is mapped to the physical, one physical address. Which is mapped to one physical address. And that's how actually now you can check, okay, trace the path with the internet, trace route, google.com. At the command prompt also you can give it. No, not necessarily in the browser. At the command prompt you can trace the path to Google. Trace RT, not ROOT. Trace route complete command is utilized on Linux terminal. RT space google.com. Now the public domain IP address of google.com is found out. You can directly give in the browser 172.217.166.46 in the browser. Enter it. You will be redirected. See here. The domain name is resolved into the IP address, which is the public domain IP address of Google. 172.217.166.46. Give it in any browser. You will be redirected to Google. Now the path. See here the path. 192 from your terminal will be the first hop to your router, broadband router, which is having IP address 192.168.1.1. Then second hop is directly to the internet, which is the path is now provided by your internet service provider, that is 103.243.114.86. That is the intermediate node. In case of our OSI model, we have seen this source A, destination B. In between, we have intermediate nodes. These are all the intermediate nodes till 172.217.166.46. All these 10.200.200.2 is an intermediate node. 103.243.115.186, it's again an intermediate node. Your source is your terminal 192.168.1.105. And your destination IP address is the public domain IP address 172.217.166.46. That's how your request for Google is being hopped. That's how you are tracing the path of your connectivity. That's the meaning of this particular command. If you somehow get involved your mobile terminal, then you can get the path from your terminal to mobile terminal, from mobile terminal to the external network. If you utilize the hotspot of your mobile, then the IP address of your terminal as well as the IP address of the mobile will be known to you. The permanent address or the physical address will be also known to you. That particular terminal should be in the flow of your network. Then only you can find out. Just check whether ARP minus A is providing you the MAC address of mobile 4. No, still not 1.105.159. No, your protocol stack is not being cleared. That's why this particular command is just for checking.
Providing.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
It's providing here.
Yeah. It's now available. This is the MAC address. You can check on your mobile now. The physical address for your terminal starts with D4C9 4B 35 1A 4F. This is the physical address of your mobile, which is a permanent address which you cannot change. ARP minus A command maintains the connectivity stack, that is resolution of IP address to physical address for only some duration. After say 15 minutes, this you will not at all view this configuration. Since we are connected by utilizing the ping attack, we have checked the connectivity with your terminal and mobile. That's why 104 is available. Your terminal is maintaining the protocol stack. This protocol stack is maintaining the mapping of IP address to physical address. The same mapping is done by your broadband router. That's why your request for mobile connectivity, you are checking your terminal with your mobile, whether both the terminals are part of the data network utilizing ping command. So both the terminals are communicating with each other. That's why the mapping is available on your terminal. That is, the packet switching path is maintained by the broadband router in the form of mapping of IP address and the physical address. Correct? Any doubt?
No, sir. Thank you.
Okay, anyone, you can stop sharing your screen. Okay, anyone has the doubt, you can ask me any sort of question related to the data networking. Try to utilize all these commands. Even if you have a mobile, on the mobile, sir, download the terminal app, which will act as a command prompt for your mobile. Yes?
By mistakenly we forgot our mobile password, then by this command prompt, can we know the password of that?
No. The password is entirely a security issue. Here, it's a networking issue. And the security issue is different. There are ways by accessing the IP address of your mobile. There are certain softwares. Just by accessing the IP address of your mobile, we'll try to locate the secret table, which will indicate the username and password for your mobile. Similar to the softwares that are utilized for the desktop PC. There are certain softwares. Just by knowing the IP address of your mobile, will provide you the username and password for your mobile. But it's quite difficult because the type of encryption technology that is supported for the mobile is somewhat complicated. It's somewhat complicated. That's why even if you lose your password, the company will give you new password. Original password is never retrieved. That is again true for the different types of passwords that you utilize for various web applications. Because for encryption, typically a SALT, S-A-L-T, you can search Google, a SALT encryption technology is utilized. So you can change the password, but you cannot retrieve the original password.
Sir.
Yes, anyone now having any doubt? All of you try these commands that we have utilized. Check what you are getting. Check the problems that you are getting. We will discuss the practicals in the all coming practicals. Okay. Should we stop today's session here? Yeah. Divesh is quite prompt. Yes. I will obey Divesh. Thank you very much. We'll stop.